Thank you. rejoice and rejoice. We sing again, the Lord has been. We sing again, that the Lord has been. I will rejoice and rejoice. We sing again, that the Lord has been.
Thank you. hands of hallelujah. Amen. To those of us who are watching us on the net, we welcome you also to this service. God will answer our prayers in the mighty name of Jesus. Those of you who are here, we thank you for being here. God will answer your prayers in the mighty name of Jesus. Please endeavor to share these messages. Not only this one, the ones that were preached before, they are all there on the channel. Share them so that you can lift up somebody's spirit. And God will also answer your own prayers in the mighty name of Jesus. Press the like button if you like our services. Pass your comments, just say it as you see it. We are open to corrections. Amen. Bible itself says that the Bible is written to correct, to improve, to, you know, guide, to counsel, to do all these things. It's, we're all learning. Nobody is an overgraduate in the Word of God. So we give glory to God for this opportunity to be here today. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you from the very beginning of this service. You have been with us. You are with us even now. Accept our thanksgiving in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Everlasting Father, we thank you for previous messages, and we thank you in advance for today's message. Let your name be glorified in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord God Almighty, we come before your throne of mercy this morning. Speak with us.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Don't let me speak of my own human wisdom. In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Today, set the captives free. Deliver the oppressed.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Father, we thank you. At the end of everything, to get take glory for yourself.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying.
Amen.
Please, can we open to the book of Genesis chapter 12, from verse 1 to 4. Let somebody find to prepare ready for us. Genesis chapter 12, from verse 1 to 4. Amen.
Now the Lord has said to Abraham,
yes,
get out of your country,
okay,
from your family,
mm,
and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you.
Mm.
I will make you a great nation.
Okay.
I will bless you.
I will bless you.
And make your name great.
And make your name great.
And you shall be a blessing.
And you shall be a blessing.
I will bless those who bless you.
I will bless those who bless you.
And I will curse him who curses you.
And whoever curses you, I will curse.
And in you,
and in you,
all the families of the
all
earth,
the families of the world shall be blessed.
Blessed.
Amen. God bless you. That's okay. That's what we need. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. To God be the glory, we are in the festive season, the one that is called Christmas. And every year we celebrate Christmas, and God will know we shall celebrate more.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
And today we are going to look at the topic, which is the essence of Christmas. The essence of Christmas celebrations. Let's put it that way. Amen. As per the timing that Christ was born, Bible scholars have established or concluded, or, you know, they have said that Christ was born in October by the descriptions given in the Bible. Then, we are celebrating him in December. Some denominations also even said that the Christmas we are celebrating now is paganistic, because this period is the period that the people of old celebrated their idols, and that it was the church, or it is the church, that changed it to Christmas. All these arguments have been going on. Also, is the Christmas celebrations commanded by the Bible? I have not found where even in Christmas itself was particularly mentioned. Maybe I'm not, like I said, nobody's is a lot as far as the Bible is concerned. So the celebration that we are celebrating, why should we celebrate Christmas? Some churches even removed it completely out of their doctrine or out of doctrinal teachings. But majority of the churches do celebrate Christmas. To me, I think the one that I know the Bible really commands is the Easter celebration. Amen. The Easter celebration is clear to all. Even though some churches still do not believe in celebrating the Easter, the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, God loves us to celebrate so many things. But He does not particularly command us. There is a difference between commandments and something that is permissible or something that is acceptable by God. Amen. When you talk of Easter, for instance, yes, you can say it is commanded. But when you talk of Christmas celebrations, it is not commanded. It is not commanded. That's why it is neither here nor there. People felt, if God can give us John 3:16, I believe we are familiar with that. Excuse me. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. There was a time in one of our Sunday school Easter teachings or something, there was this question that came. The question was that, which is better? Or which one is better than the other? The celebration of Christmas or the celebration of Easter, which is the resurrection. Amen. Arguments went on to and fro. The question is, if Christ was not born, will you have salvation? Will you have the resurrection? Yes, the Bible allows that we celebrate Easter. But if Christ was not born, what are we going to celebrate in Easter? Amen. Amen. So some people said it is better to celebrate the Christmas because that was when our Savior came into the world. We just read Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 to 4. What we are celebrating in Christmas today is what was predicted in that Genesis 12, 1 to 4, particularly about verse 4, where it says, through you, the entire families of the world shall be blessed. Amen. Amen. And the greatest blessing that we had is the coming of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
If you go to Isaiah 61, verse 1 to 4, can somebody please read that to us? Isaiah 61, 1 to 4. Amen. There was still this prediction, prophecy, as to what will still happen. Amen.
Amen.
Isaiah 61, verse 1 to 4.
The Spirit of the Lord is upon me.
The Spirit of the Lord is upon me.
Because the Lord has anointed me.
To preach good tidings, yes?
To the meek.
The gentle. He has sent me to do what?
Behind the broken hearted.
To bind
the broken hearted.
To heal the broken heart and let them lead the captive. To bring liberty to the captive.
And the opening of the prison
to them that are in prison.
To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord.
And the day of vengeance.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. To bring consolation to those that mourn.
Amen.
This was still a prophecy in Isaiah. This was still a prophecy in Isaiah. It was a prophecy in Genesis 12. Still a prophecy in Isaiah. But by the time we got to John 3:16, then what the reason why Christ was given? Christ himself, I mean, it has been explained there in Isaiah 12, Isaiah 61, verse 1 to 4. That the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. That was what Jesus repeated in Luke 19, sir. Luke 19, the one we got earlier. Amen. Please check it. In New Testament, where it has been fulfilled, amen. I think it's Luke 19, is it? You got it earlier. Amen. Yeah. Luke 19 or something. Is it 9 or 19? Let's be. So, the coming, I think it's, is it 14? We got it earlier.
But his citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him, no. Saying.
No, that's not it. It's Luke 4:18. Amen. God bless you. Please, can I read it up for us? Luke 4:18. This word has been fulfilled already. Jesus, yes.
The Spirit of the Lord is upon me.
Because he has anointed me. Repeated in Isaiah 61, 1 to 4, yes.
To preach the gospel
to the poor.
He has sent me to heal the broken.
He has sent me. Look at the missions of Jesus Christ. He has sent me to heal the broken hearted.
To preach
deliverance to those who are in captivity.
And
recovery of sight to those who are blind spiritually.
Then
those of them that are oppressed will put them or to set them at liberty. Amen. Praise the Lord. This is where the essence of the Christmas we are celebrating here manifested. Christ was, from birth, Christ has been studying the word of God. We are told by the time Jesus Christ was 12 years old, he has started teaching in the synagogues. People wondered where he got his wisdom from. Three things that Christ teach that made his ministry outstanding was, first of all, he studied the word of God according to what Joshua 1, 8 to 10 shows that we should study the word of God day and night, meditate upon it all the time, and the devil to do what is inside. And according to Hosea 4, 7, Hosea 4, 6, that we know, my people perish from lack of knowledge of me, Jesus Christ, the first thing, and let's take that with Matthew 6, 33. Let's take Hosea 4, 6 with Matthew 6, 33 that says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and every other thing shall be added unto it. Christ Jesus himself lived by the example of what the Bible says in Genesis and Joshua 1, 8 to 10. He studied the word of God thoroughly to the point that at the age of 12, he had started teaching. Then he had full knowledge of the word of God. He did not lack understanding of his father. Hosea 4, 6. Amen. By the time we now got to Luke 4:18. Jesus was in the temple. They brought the scroll to him. It was read to him. Then he said, he declared, he discovered, he saw the fulfillment. He knew the timing. He heard that was the time. He performed a miracle at the wedding where, you know, the mother told him, you know, he told me wine has finished, his son went and influenced my time has not come. He knew that his time had not come there. Even though in obedience to do honor to his parents and to feel, begin to seek to have a taste, a foretaste of what he has come for. Miracles. He performed that miracle. May the Lord God Almighty perform the miracles that you least expected to happen in your lives in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
So, by the time his time came, he knew. Amen. He knew. He read the scroll. He said the scroll was read to him. And he spoke of exactly what was said in Isaiah 61:1-4. Because if you look at him word for word, let me also tell you, most of Christ's teachings were taken from the Old Testament. The fulfillment of them were in the New Testament, where Christ would speak. He would forgive your enemies. Instead of praying against them, pray for them. He said, they are all in the Old Testament. He said, don't pray evil for evil. Amen. Christ knew. He studied the Word of God very well. Having studied the Word of God very well, everything to him was clear, crystal clear. So the day his time came to begin his ministry, you can imagine. The ministry that he will practice for 3.5 years, he studied for it for 30 years. Amen.
Amen.
That tells us that the time for preparation, the time for planning, is always far longer than the time to execute a plan. Let me give you a physical example. You want to get married. Is it the day you want to get wedded that you begin to plan all your weddings? Ew, those of you who are married. Amen? Okay, so those who are not yet married, let me tell you, it's not the same day, because those who may not want to tell you the truth. Because for a year plus, you would have been planning what to do as soon as time. You organize the people, you fix the dates, you begin to choose your dates that you go to the registry, and you meet with your pastors on where you want to do it, and you all agree parents will meet, you know, and then of course your courtship still goes on. Amen. Everything will not happen in a day. Not everything happens in a day. Everything goes step by step, just like we were taught in our Sunday school. Christ took his time. He knew he was the Messiah all along, but he did not just jump into it and just wake up one morning and say, I'm doing miracles. Or I want to start. No. And the day he realized that, he discovered, or the day that he knew that his time has come, he repeated what purpose he was sent to come and fulfill in this world. Amen.
Amen.
That's what he did in Luke 4:18. Repeating Isaiah 61:1-4. The same thing today, you and I. Maybe we have not realized it because we didn't study the Bible. Maybe because we do not, you know, we have not yet developed real personal relationship with God Almighty. We didn't even know when God has called us, where He has called us. We did not search the scriptures. Matthew 28:16. Please let somebody please read. We'll stop at the comfortable place. Matthew 28. Many of us have been saying, well, I'm not called. Because even in our church, present day church, they will tell you, are you called to preach and teach the word of God? Are you? Yes. Matthew 28.
Then the 11 disciples went away.
Then the 11 disciples went away So that you will please come forward, yes, so that we can hear you. Will please come here.
Into our mouth,
I'm sorry. I'm not even surprised. Even in the Muslim community, Orlando sang a song which I never forget. He said, Eko Adu Gogo Eni Mali. They are only Marika Desala. Eni Mali. Only she wanted nothing to say. And then you have to empire. He shall not pass it by. It's a means that you give to those in need. It's not the means that you share amongst yourself. You know, I give you my own, you give me my own. The means is supposed to be given to those who have no needs to eat at all. Amen. Can you see some similarity in the Boxing Day celebration and even the Muslims in layout, whatever they call it? Amen. Everything that God has been emphasizing is that you should remember the needy, the poor, the widows, those who are in need. You have bought bags of rice, you bought minerals. Those minerals are supposed to go to those who are in need. Not that I give you my own, you give me my own. Amen. You give me your own. Please, let's read that. Matthew 23, verse 22.
Woe unto you, scribes,
religious people, those of us who are going to fasting and prayer 100 days a month, and then those of us who are going to mountains, those of us who are in performing religious activities in the city or in the open, those of us who are in beaches, woe unto you, those of you who are paying tithes and your regularly you are paying your offerings, yes, yes,
and Pharisees,
you Sadducees and Pharisees,
hypocrites.
You are hypocrites.
For ye pay tithes of
you pay tithes of means, yes.
And anise.
And
anise.
Anise, yes.
And cumin.
And cumin.
And have omitted the weightier matter.
Then something that is greater, you have omitted. Amen. What is the weightier matter? We have been debating the issue of tithing and others, even though the Bible itself in Hebrew 4, Hebrew 7, 14 to 22 has already erased that. But people would rather die. People would tell lies. I tell you, you don't make heaven unless you pay your tithe. People would rather tell you that if you meet your tithe, you will die because they are profiting from it. What God has given you. You are paying all those things. Yes, please. You left the weightier matter. Which one is the weightier matter? Yes, sir.
Of the law.
Of the law. The time of the law. The laws have been erased. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Judgment.
Judgment,
mercy,
and faith.
These ought ye to have done.
Hey, all these words, you are supposed to judge in righteousness. You are supposed to have mercy upon your neighbor. You have to love your God and love your neighbor as yourself. That's just them. And then you have to have faith. Amen. You have left these matters, these important matters, and you are sharing Christ. You are sharing coke. You are changing your apparel to new one because Christmas is here. You are eating new fat. You have and some of us, please be seated. Some of us were able to go to the extra miles of going to save into adultery and fornication. You come home from wherever you stay. Your boyfriends are waiting for you in your village. Or some of you will travel to your boyfriends. In the name of what? In the name of Christmas. And even during the Christmas, you never one day visited before. You never remember anybody, but all you are after is, the festive mood. You have left the weightier matter. The essence of Christmas is salvation. Remember, evangelism for yesterday, the day of the Christmas itself. Then today, giving gifts to the people that are in need. People that are in need, the poor, the widows, the people that are unable to take good care of them. That which you have to give to them, you left that. But you did need it. I know that the way we are surrounding here, for the past 2 weeks or so, vigils have been going on. Vigils have been going on. All those ones are useless unless on a day like this you go about, giving what you have to the best of your ability to your neighbors. To those, identify the needs. There are orphanage homes. There are people who are hungry. Imagine if you don't remember them anyway, remember them today. That is the essence. Then those who have no salvation at all, those who don't know Christ, these are the days you set aside exclusively to preach and teach them the word of God. Baptize them. That's why those who are going blessed who are fishing on seasons like this, they are very correct. Amen. God, the essence is not for men making. It is to win souls, and it is to, how do you win souls? You give gifts to them. Then you preach to them. You baptize them. You bring them to the family of God. Amen. Bring them from their idol worship. Bring them from their wicked ways to the way of peace. He is the Prince of Peace. Amen.
Amen.
This is the day that you set aside to remember the Lord your God. Then we said in Luke 11:41. Amen. Say so practically the same thing with Matthew 23:23. Yes?
But rather give alms. Of such things. As you have.
Give alms of such things as you have.
And behold. All things are clean unto you.
All things are clean unto you. Give to people. That's what it means. So especially those who are in need. There are children now who have not paid their school fees. There are children. And you are in a position to do it. Please don't misunderstand. Nobody says you are still to give to anybody. You don't have prayer for the person. But if you have, if it lies within your capacity to do it, 2 Corinthians 8:9, on how to give. It has to be voluntary, it has to be, for a purpose. Amen. So these are the things that we ought to do. Then those of us who are, nobody is against your fasting is very profitable to your health. Amen. If you are a gluten, you will die quickly. You will have diabetes. You will have all sorts of diseases. If you are the one that is eating without break, you need fasting. In fact, in a world of 366 days that you have in the year, you don't need to eat more than at maximum, maybe between half and just one third. The rest should be for fasting. But you have to do it with wisdom. There is a way you do it. It's not that you just abandon food, you can enjoy yourself. But fasting is very, very essential for us. So there is nothing wrong if you do all those things. There is even nothing wrong if you give gifts to people. There is nothing wrong if you go for your prayer meetings and all that. Nothing is wrong. But what the weightier matter is after all these rituals, many of you forget to remember your parents. Did I hear somebody say, I'm still small. I'm in school, so I haven't got anything to give to. No, you have so much to give. When your parents send you a errand, go quickly, cheerfully. That's what you have. Then you are doing little more there and there. From the little you have, give little to your parents. And let your charity begin at home. Not that you go out and buy beer, suya, and what do you call it? Suya, whatever. To be man, and so God bless you. Well, I know the English equivalent of Asun. What do they call it? You don't even know. So, Asun, and then Asun is Asun, and then that's your pepper soup and all that. You do that. You go outside and you are giving to them. Your parents are not eating well at home. Woe unto such person. Amen. Let's take the essence of Christmas again in James 1:27. Amen. James 1:27. Let's also see how all these religious activities are attained.
Pure religion.
Christianity religion. Christmas that you are celebrating, yes.
Are not defiled before God.
Are not.
And undefiled.
The one that is pure before the eyes of the God. Of God.
And the Father.
The one that God has sent. The one that has heavenly connotation.
Is this. To visit the fatherless.
Visit the I mean, not chicken in one week, not carrying your girlfriends, not visiting your, who are they? You know who this is, no? Not handlers, not prostitutes, yes.
And widows.
And widows.
Their affliction.
Those who are in trouble, remember them that you know, that are close to you, that you know that are in trouble that time. Visit them and console them, give them what to have, yes?
And to keep himself unspotted from the world.
And to keep yourself unspotted. Pure, clean, before the eyes of God. Did Jesus not say, hey, look, surprises will happen in heaven when you get there. And I will say, I know you, but he will say, how? So he will heal his sick. I say, you did that, but when I was hungry, you did not give me food. When I was thirsty, you did not give me water. When I was homeless, you did not house me. When I was clothless, you did not clothe me. What did he say? He said, I mean. And then they were asking, how will you say? The only way to do that one, to store your treasures in heaven with me, that you will now gain from when you get to heaven, is when you do it to these poor people that are listed here. The needy. Yes, your pastor has a need. If God lays upon your heart to do so, please meet it. But look at those destitutes. Look at those people that their mothers gave birth to them and threw them away. The government took over and are taking care of them. Look at the children that you have the capability of supporting in school. You have the capability of saying that. Because you have to be true to yourself. Not that this has me to be that I did, and because I don't have the capability, I went to steal. No. If you like, go and do your arm robbery and then go and do your Yahoo and then go and give billions to the church of God. Give billions to the pastors. It has no reward. No pleasant reward. If there's anything in the world, is helpless. Amen. That will not be our question in the mighty name of Jesus. So the time for Christmas is the time for reflection. Thank God that Christ was born. Because if it wasn't born, there would have been, what do you call it? The dream or the vision of God would have been aborted. So that it could, that, but the more important one is that he died and he resurrected. That's Easter. So I'm preparing your heart towards Easter now. So that you know that it's not all about meeting God or food, or going with your girlfriend or boyfriend, or going about doing what is not relevant to the essence of what you're doing. Many of us are celebrating without being a sense of always celebrating. Just the idea of doing that will do it. We go to church only on Christmas Day and New Year Day because we want to see another year. Amen. It's very wrong. Then, celebration is about thanksgiving to the Lord. Amen. To give thanks. Yes, that we'll see another year. We'll see another Christmas. It's about reflection, thinking about what to do to please God. Amen. Which are the things that are taught us here. So, many of us, we misinterpret the word of God. We don't know how to, we have a personal relationship with God Almighty. I would say we are celebrating Christmas. We are just playing games, which has no profit. Towards our heavenly world. The Lord will help us in the mighty name of Jesus. We need to understand that even if we pay less of eating and dining and winding, we should pay less attention to them. Pay more attention to doing what the Lord has us to do. To visit the needy, to visit the poor, to visit the oppressed. To preach the acceptable year of the Lord. To give deliverance to those who are in captivity, those who don't know God, meet them, preach to them. When they come, you take them, teach them the word of God so that they can retain the word of God in their lives and their lives. And they too will also grow to become like you. Amen. Amen. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. So to me, it's not a question of whether you celebrate Christmas or you don't celebrate Christmas. What do you do? We for that celebration. This is your birthday, honestly speaking. On your birthday, instead of warning the rich and the wealthy to do together, to come and dine and wine, why not package that food and go and give it to the family or give them raw so that they can eat? Honestly, the one that is acceptable to God Almighty is not the one you need to feed all this, your invited guests. It is the one that you gave to the needy, the poor, the orphan, the helpless, the helpless in society. By the time we understand this, even our orientation will change. Even the celebrations we are making, maybe wedding and all these things, or funerals, people must give food, honestly speaking. Major part of the food should go to the needy. Amen. These are the things that we are saying, because these are really hungry. Even we invite them, maybe, you know, we have the habit of God, they will give me something. So we invite the whole world. And if you do your calculation well, you don't even need to carry more than actually that you inflated the prices. No matter how much you spend, I mean, no matter how much they gave to you, it cannot be more than one third of what you have spent. Go and check it. Whether you check your P&L profit and loss account after any celebration. But it's more profitable if some of this is going to the people that are really more than the need. The Lord bless us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So in summary, like I said, it's not a question of whether we believe in Christmas or we don't believe in Christmas. Celebration is God loves celebration. To praise Him, to rejoice with Him, to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Amen. Psalm 100 verse 1, let's all read that to us. Amen. And 98 verse 1 to 4, I think. 100 verse 1. Amen. Every time you are celebrating, make sure it is that you are making a joyful noise unto the Lord God Almighty, who has spared your life, giving you the opportunity to do that celebration. Yes, Aaron.
Make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you land.
Hello, ma'am. Let the young one. Thank you, ma'am. God bless you. Yes. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the land, everybody in the land, yes. Serve the Lord with
gladness.
Come into His presence with singing. That's celebration. Amen. That is why when we come to the house of the Lord, we sing praise, worship, and we do all those things. They are very important. Come unto Him with gladness. Amen. Psalm 98. 98. Then we want to. Let's stop and come to
Sing unto the Lord.
A new song.
For He has done marvelous
things. He has done marvelous things in your life. Can't we celebrate God for sparing our lives to see another Christian? Can't we celebrate God for sparing our lives to behold a new year? Amen. If you are having who have left this year. Amen. For God's year to life. Yes, sir.
His right hand.
And his holy arm.
Has gotten him the victory.
It is the victory of God we all try for God. Amen. How many of us find the battles of our life? God Almighty finds the battles that gives us the victory free of time. God bless you. Please be seated. Amen. God loves celebration. If you read the book of the Kings, it is celebration. Anyone? When Vashti lost her husband, what was the husband doing? He had celebrated for 2.5 months, every day, food, everybody was eating and wine. And unfortunately, the thing went to the wrong side. And the innocent became a victim of problems. So it has been a problem. We are always saying, that's why sometimes we always have questions like, why did you allow these things to happen? For God knows what is even from the angel, he brings something that is good. The king did not take that decision to say the wife to come and show her beauty before the public until he has gotten drunk. The repercussion of God is can lead to anything. Even though God has brought something to the heart of this, we men, we should be careful with wine. Amen. It can bring evil. he crossed the mind of the king to say the wife should come and dance to her nakedness, and he clearly refused, as she may committed any offense. But when God brought something about from there, whoever anybody that the destiny will conflict with your own, God will separate the two of them.
Amen.
But yeah. What happened was that the destiny of Esther was conflicting with the destiny of Pastor. The destiny of the poor is contending with the destiny of the rich. Amen. Pastor was in a comfortable zone. We don't know what she did earlier. Maybe she was thinking towards the poor before. And God wanted to crown the poor to replace her. You will not be replaced. Amen. I shall not be replaced. Amen. In the mighty name of Jesus. Shall we make it right? The essence of our celebration should be to please God, to praise God. So, and then the manifestation of it should be to reach out to the needy in our little way, the best way we can. Give to the poor, give to the needy. Remember the widow, remember the orphan, remember the orphanage. Orphanage groups are everywhere. Remember them, no matter how little. That which you consider little is big in the eyes of God and is the treasure in heaven. The Lord will bless us in Jesus' name. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you. That we will bless you, we honor your praise. Thank you for your message today. Accept our thanksgiving in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you because you bring the clarity to us that all these are very naked. They are self-centered. The people that should be very naked, those who should have tiny meal, are the